Okay, so first of all, thank you for giving me opportunity to talk. And I will, like, this is the first lecture in the series, but it's actually like the series is planned for about two topics. And this is a topic like about invariance of rank two distributions, where invariants of curves in projective spaces or generalized Wilczynski invariants. And well, I know that I actually gave talks for some of you about this topic many times, so I apologize that I will repeat something like, but the emphasis of this talk is to give you a feeling that actually this method gives a rather effective and explicit algorithm to calculate invariants of rank two distributions in manifolds of any dimension. And so it's more like about computational aspects. I arrived to computational aspects, and so so it's not like a general theory. So first of all, I want to fix some notation. So we work with distributions. So for us, D denotes a rank L distribution on N dimensional manifold. And we shortly will say that it is LN, L comma N distribution. And then taking iterative Lie brackets of vector fields tangent to distributions, we can produce a flag on each tangent space at every point. So it's like D is equal to D to the power one, and then we can construct D squared, and so on, j's power of d. So d1 is just d, and d square, like symbolically, it's d plus d brackets d with d. In general, we actually can write just brackets d with d, it will give you the same. And well, this is equal to span of all, like if we choose a local basis of a distribution, then it is equal to span of these vectors together with mutual Lie brackets evaluated at point Q. And then we recursively the j's power is equal to dj minus one plus d brackets with dj minus one. And this is actually, in terms of local basis, it is a span of all iterated Lie brackets of length not greater than j of the fields xi at q of the local basis at q. And so this defines what is called weak derived flag. Well, in sometimes people use what is called strong derived flag or big flag, when at every step you iterate actually not with d but with the previous, namely here it will be d to the power g minus one brackets with d to the power g minus one. So we will work with weak derived flag. And so this is a notation. So d to the power j is called the j's power of the distribution. And then this filtration is called weak derived flag. And then if we pick up tuple of dimensions, then it is called small growth vector, or shortly as GV of distribution at point Q. So in general, the dimensions of powers may vary from point to point, but at generic point they will be constant. And And also we consider bracket generating distributions, namely means that some power of D for every Q, there is a power of D such that this power is equal to the whole tangent space at given point, and this power is called degree of non-holonomial distribution. And so we are speaking about equivalence problem. And so like the equivalence problem for distributions, and there are like originally there was Cartan equivalence method of constructing canonical coframe on certain bundle over a manifold and solving the equivalence problem in terms of this coframe. And it was successfully applied in particular for rank 2 distribution in 5 dimensions. Then like another method of development was Tanaka series, the Tanaka prolongation procedure, which is the algebraic version of the Cartan equivalence method, and developed originally by Tanaka and his school. And this theory works especially well for the case of parabolic geometries, as was discussed by Dennis in the lecture series of Dennis Ze. And so the other approach that we also listen, we had lectures about by Misha Zhytomyrsky, is the method of normal forms, which were originated by Poincaré and Dulac for vector fields, and then Moser applied it for well stable distributions and non-degenerate CR structures. And then after Moser, many others like the whole community in CR geometry use the method of normal forms of normalization of quasi-homogeneous jets. And so like all these methods give you a way of to calculate invariance of in particular of rank 2 distribution in 5 dimension, and in general any distribution with constant Tanaka symbol. And I want to focus on sort of alternative approach, which can be called the simplification procedure via abnormal extremals and Jacobi curves, which were developed or originated by Andrei Agrachev, and then were developed further by me and Boris Dubrov. And the main idea of this method is that actually, like applied to distribution, is that you have a lot of special curves, or they're called singular curves or abnormal extremal trajectories, which are associated with distribution. And actually the geometry of distribution itself can be studied where the path geometry of these curves. But the point is that everything is seen better when we actually lift ourselves from the original manifold to the cotangent bundle of it. And actually all on the cotangent bundle, the new structures are induced, and then like you arrive to some non-trivial structures there that give invariance of the original structure. So therefore, like, first of all, I need some maybe reminder for some of you about basic structures on the cotangent bundle. So the cotangent bundle is a set of pairs P and Q, where Q is a point on a manifold and P is a covector or an element of the cotangent space. And so it's natural bundle. So let's pi is the canonical bundle projection. And so first of all, on the cotangent bundle, we have so-called tautological or Liouville one form. I denoted by S. And so to define this form, we just, at a point lambda, we just have to say what is the value of this form on a given vector, tangent vector V to actually this. Okay, so it should be t lambda of t star m. Okay, so v is belongs to t lambda of t star m. So v is tangent space at tangent vector at lambda to t star m. And so when we project this v to the manifold, then you obtain a vector of the tangent space, and then like S of lambda of V is actually equal, so you apply P, which is a covector, to the vector. Yes, so let me just yes, so this must be T lambda T star n. Okay. Anyway, I will erase it because so and then we have this so we have tautological one form, and then we can define the canonical symplectic structure, symplectic form as a differential of this tautological one form. And then in local canonical coordinates in the cotangent space induced from coordinates on a manifold, the tautological Liouville one form is this, like I use here the Einstein notation, and the canonical symplectic form is this. Is there any questions so far? Everything is fine. Hello?
Yeah, everything is good.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. So then, and then like it's more convenient for us actually to work instead of cotangent bundle, it's more convenient to work on the projectivization of cotangent bundle, which I denote by P of T star M. And the projectivization is just the bundle with the fibers, which are projective spaces or projectivizations of the fibers of the cotangent bundle. And then like the tautological one form S on T star M induces the canonical contact distributions on the projectivization to T star M. So on P T star M, we don't have like one form, but we can take a kernel of this one form on T star M, and then the push forward by the canonical, by this canonical projection of this kernel to the projectivization will define Courant 1 distribution, and this Courant 1 distribution is contact, and I denoted by D delta tilde. And then here is the point that we like in the cotangent bundle, we can consider the dual objects to to the powers of distribution. Namely, once we have a distribution on M, you can consider the annihilators of any of its power. So what is the annihilator of J's power of D? So DJ, D to the power J perp is actually the set of pairs PQ in T star M such that P annihilates any vector in the J's power. Yes. And in the same way as we did projectivization of cotangent bundle, we can make projectivization of the fibers of the annihilator, and it will be denoted by this pi d to the power j perp. And okay, so and then now we restrict ourselves to rank two distributions. In this case, for example, in this case, we will work with annihilator of d square, and this annihilator, and we consider rank two distribution, bracket generating rank two distribution, so a generic point dimension of d square must be equal to 3, so we will assume that we have this at every point, that d square is three-dimensional, and then what is the dimension of the projectivization? So first of the annihilator of d square, so the dimension of annihilator of d square is 2n minus the dimension of d square, which is 3, but projectivizing reduced dimension by 1, so we obtain 2n minus 4, yes? So we have, in particular, it is even dimensional. And then remember, canonical contact distribution on the projectivization of the cotangent bundle. And then we can restrict this canonical contact distribution to this space, to projectivization of this annihilator of this square, just making intersection of this contact distribution with the tangent space to this projectivization. And well, in general, and then on some actually open dense set in this projectivization, this will define you what is called even contact distribution. So the in general, this d bar might have singularities, but we go out of the singularities, and then in this space, like when we actually remove from d square annihilator, we remove d cube annihilator, then this distribution is even contact. What does it mean, even contact? So it means that if we consider a defining form of this, so in any case, it's a Courant one distribution. If we consider the defining form, one form of it, namely that the distribution is a kernel of this defining form, yes, then we can restrict the differential of this defining one form to the distribution itself. And remember, the dimension of the space projectivation of annihilator of d square is even, so the dimension of the fibers of d delta bar is odd, and so the kernel is always, this kernel is always non-trivial. And in this case, this kernel is of minimal possible dimension, which is 1. And so it means that in this specific space, submanifold of the projectivization of cotangent bundle, you have at every point, you have a special direction. Or like this kernels of these restrictions define what is called characteristic rank one distribution in this space, which we denote by like this space we denote by WD, and the characteristic rank one distribution we denote by C. And the integral curves of this characteristic distributions in control series are called regular abnormal extremals, and the projections to the manifold they are called abnormal trajectories, and they play certain role or important role in optimal control problems with distribution being constraints. But like from geometric point of view, also in symplectic or contact geometry, this is just characteristic distribution, so characteristic foliation on even dimensional submanifold of a symplectic manifold. So here is the picture. I just draw a picture both in the projectivized space and in the cotangent bundle itself. The point is like it's more geometrically, it's more convenient to work with projectivization, but like in actual computation, in like in local frames and local coordinates, we one certainly works in the cotangent bundle. So the picture is the same, actually, just the right side of this table goes to the left side by the canonical projection capital pi. But okay, so then like what here is the picture. So we have projectivization of cotangent bundle. Inside of it, you have even dimensional submanifold, projectivization of annihilator of D squared. Inside of it, at every point except some singular set, or which is projectivization of cube, annihilator of cube, at every point you have a special line in the tangent space, and you can, and this line distribution defines your characteristic line foliation, but in the special points it degenerate to a point. It's like singular points of the corresponding like field of direction. Yes, this is a picture. Any questions so far, or like? Hello?
I think everything is clear. If anyone has a question, they can.
Yeah, I mean, I just want to make sure that I'm not offline, because sometimes.
Yes,
no.
Yes, I understand. Everything okay. Is clear.
Yeah. All right. And then like, so we also, so then what we can do, we can like, at least we can work locally in some tubular neighborhood of a given leaf of this characteristic foliation, and we can consider the leaf space, namely when we take a quotient of so O of gamma is actually some neighborhood of a given leaf gamma, and then we can quotient by this, at least in this neighborhood, we can quotient by this characteristic foliation, and we obtain a leaf space. Now we can well-defined now 2n minus 5 dimensional manifold. So I recall you that the dimension of projectivization was 2n minus 4, but if we quotient by line one dimensional foliation, we obtain something of dimension one less. And so this is called it's locally we have leave space, so it's like, let me see, so it's like you, the picture is like this, so you have, so you you have like a specific leaf gamma, and then you have, so you can sort of consider a submanifold which is transversal to all leaves, and this is actually representative of this quotient manifold N. Yes, so such that like any leaf actually intersect this transversal submanifold at exactly at one point. So the points of N are each point of N is actually a leaf or an abnormal extreme. Yes, and so if we have, okay, so I have to remove this annotate. Okay, so if we, oh, but then sorry, I have to erase this. Okay, so then, and then remove, okay. So, all right, so then let us denote by capital phi the canonical projection to the quotient manifold, and then we have this nice picture, which is a picture of double vibration. So, like what we have here. So we, okay, so this, the point is that we quotient by the kernel of, or like actually Cauchy characteristic or kernel of D sigma. And therefore, when we push forward this distribution, this even contact distribution delta bar from T star M, or from this space to the space of leaves, then you obtain a well-defined distribution. Yes, I mean, because we quotient actually by the symmetry of delta bar, and so now, and then like the delta bar was Coronc one distribution in here, and then and the characteristic line distribution was sub distribution of it, so the rank of distribution delta is one less than the rank of distribution delta bar, and so we obtain actually distribute again, we have here this delta is Coronc one distribution in this space, in odd dimensional space, and this is will be always contact. So we like the quotient of even contact by Cauchy characteristic is contact. So it means that like if we make like the quotient by phi and pull back by the phi star, then on the leaf space N, so N is the leaf space of abnormal extremes, you have a canonically defined contact distribution. So and overall on this submanifold WD, I recall you what is WD, is just projectivization of D squared annihilator minus some singular set. So we actually have here, we have a structure of double vibration, because on one hand, we have a projection to original manifold induced by the projection of the cotangent bundle to the original manifold, right? On one hand, we have this projection pi. On the other hand, we have projection to the leaf space of abnormal extremes, at least locally. But since it is local series, that we can reduce, restrict ourselves to local picture. And yes, and this structure of double vibration we can use. So then like what we can do, here is a picture. We like inside of, in M, on the tangent bundle of M, you have a distribution, right? Then we can actually lift it, this distribution, actually pull back this distribution to upstairs, to this space. And so this is exactly what I denote by D hat, the pullback of D. So the meaning is actually that it's the set of all vectors in the tangent space to WD such that the projection is D. Yes, we can pull back, but then we actually can push forward this D hat by the other projection, or by the projection to the second, to the, like, we can use the second vibration, and we can project this D hat to the tangent space to the leaf space of abnormal extremals. Yes, so this is what we do here. And we take phi lower star of D hat lambda. And actually all, but then the point is that this does not define you a distribution. Like actually this push forwards will depend on lambda, like for any lambda. Like if you fix lambda in the same leaf, then you actually have like the push forwards will define different subspaces in the fiber of this contact distribution delta. So this is a picture. So like so means that like in here in delta gamma, like you have the gamma is a point of the leaf space, or equivalent, it is abnormal extremal. And for every point, to any point lambda in gamma, you can assign a subspace in delta gamma. And all together, if you vary lambda, then also the subspaces vary, and then you obtain a curve in the corresponding Grassmannian. You obtain, so namely like here in this picture, like in this leg, you like you don't have just a contact distribution, but inside of each fiber of this contact distribution, you have actually a curve of subspaces. And moreover, just by construction, first of all, I forgot to say, yes, so like any contact distribution is actually endowed with a conformal symplectic structure, namely symplectic for non-degenerate skew symmetric form, which is defined up to multiplication by a constant. And this symplectic form is exactly the differential of a defining form restricted to the fiber. And this constant comes from the fact that defining form is defined up to a multiplication by a function. So the differential at every point is defined. A restriction of differential is defined up at every point up to a multiplication by a constant. And so therefore we can speak like on each fiber. So, okay, so this J gamma that I define as a push forwards, they subspaces in delta gamma, a curve of subspaces, but these subspaces are actually Lagrangian subspaces with respect to this conformal symplectic structure. So namely the restriction of this conformal symplectic structure to each of them is zero, So, and this curve of subspaces is called Jacobi curve. And well, the reason for this is that it has something actually direct relation to Jacobi equations for along extremals or along geodesics. And now you can ask what happened, like what we actually did in a sense. So like we actually like we studied dynamics of the lift of the original distribution along the first fiber, lift by the first vibration along the leaves or fibers of the second vibration. What if we will do opposites, that if we will consider, for example, C is actually distribution tangent to the leaves of the second vibration. If we will push forward them by the projection of the first vibration, if you consider pi star of C, what happens? Nothing special happens, because this, if you collect all this pi star of C, then it just will sweep the distribution. So like the union of all these images will give you the whole D. So there is no any non-trivial additional structure. While in here you have non-trivial additional structure, because you have a curve in Lagrange-Grassmannian. Yes, and this actually eliminates the fact that actually on the projections of abnormal extremes are called abnormal trajectories or singular curves, and this the fact that this collection defines the whole D it means that actually any direction of a distribution there are at least one abnormal extremal trajectory. Like in the case of 2-5 distribution, you have exactly one, but in general there are plenty of them. So there is n minus 5 dimensional family of distributions of abnormal trajectories which start at given point in given direction. Okay, so all right, and so you have this. Finally, we arrive to this Jacobi curve. And so what we can do with this, we actually can produce Jacobi curve is a curve in Lagrange-Grassmannian, curve of Lagrangian subspaces. So what we can do with this, we can consider the flux of osculating subspaces. So like we can produce actually a complete flux here, like by making osculations and skew symmetric complements. So you start with your J gamma at a given point, and then you consider osculation. So what is the I's osculating space, J gamma I, with I greater equals than zero. This is the following. So like you can, if you have a curve in Grassmannian, then you can consider it as a tautological vector bundle over itself, namely if the fiber over a point of a curve is a subspace corresponding to this point, because the point is also a subspace. Yes, and then we can speak about sections, space of sections of this tautological vector bundle. Yes, and we will denote it by gamma of J gamma small, and then the I's osculating space of J gamma is actually span of all derivatives up to order I of all sections of J-gamma. I mean, here we somehow parameterize the curve. In general, this curve is not parameterized. This is an important point. And then we define this. Of course, this doesn't depend on parameterization. So this is nice osculating space. So we obtain a sequence of nested subspaces. And then, this produce half of our flux that we want. And the other half can be obtained by taking skew symmetric complements. So namely, J gamma minus one is J gamma, skew symmetric complement of J gamma is J gamma itself, because J gamma is Lagrangian, but then J gamma one, the skew symmetric complement gives you something inside of J gamma and so on. And the point is that for rank two distributions, the jump of dimensions of the subspaces is not greater than one. And for example, the J gamma minus one is actually push forward of the vertical distribution with respect to, this is vertical distribution with respect to this fiber, pi star going, not from respect to phi star, but pi star, okay. So, and J gamma minus one is push forward of this vertical distribution. So, okay. So this is, so it's bundle pi double d to m. Okay. So
Igor, may I ask you? I want to clarify for myself. So you constructed Jacobic curve. In construction, it is parameterized or not parameterized?
In construction, it's not parameterized.
Already in construction, it's not parameterized.
Yes, because you don't. It's a leaf space, so you don't have anything. I mean, any specific parameter. Like if you do the same for say Sub-Riemannian geometry, then they are parameterized.
Okay.
But here it is not.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Okay. Thanks.
Okay. Okay. All right. So then I have to remove this. Sorry about. Okay, and then we obtain a flux of curves instead of a curve of subspaces, we obtain curve of flux, and then this curve of flux may have singularities, and this is important to impose some regularity condition. So the curve is called, J gamma is called regular if the subspace J gamma lambda do not belong to a fixed hyperplane. So if it indeed moves and sweeps the whole delta gamma at the end. And then, but in this case, it means that for generic lambda, the following three mutually equivalent condition hold, and I will, if one of them hold, I will call some people call this convex, and some for some reason that there is no sort of inflection points. So first equivalent condition is that show all of them. So that actually, basically it means that at every osculation, the jump of dimension is exactly one. So it, in n minus three steps, and why n minus three is remember that the rank of the dimension of delta gamma is two times n minus three. And so J gamma is half-dimensional subspace. So Lagrangian half-dimensional subspace. Lagrangian means half-dimensional subspace. Yes, such that the restriction of symplectic form is zero. So then like in n minus three steps, we exactly obtain from n minus three dimensional subspace, the whole ambient space. And this is exactly means that the flux is actually complete, namely like you have like exactly like all numbers between all dimensions between one and two times n minus three.
Just checking delta gamma is two n minus six, right?
Two n minus six, namely two times n minus three. Yes, and then in particular, it means that, well, basically, instead of considering the whole flux, we can consider just the one dimensional the curve of one dimensional subspaces of the flux. Like J gamma four minus n is one dimensional, and actually, it produces the whole flux by osculation, like all other subspaces of the flux comes from osculation of this one. Yes, and like there is another detail that actually this curve, so namely instead of Jacobi curve, which is a curve in Lagrange-Grassmannian, we just can consider a curve in projective space. But the detail here is that it's not arbitrary curve of projective space, but it's so-called self-dual curve, and I will speak about it later. What is this? But basically it means that the osculation of dimension, which is equal to half dimension of the spaces, is Lagrangian with respect to some symplectic form in one of the equivalent definitions. And then we, in general, like this flux may have singularities. I mean, there might be points lambda such that J gamma, if gamma is abnormal external passing through lambda, then J gamma, the flux of J gamma at lambda is not complete. It doesn't satisfy this convexity condition. So therefore, like we single out what I call Jacobi regularity locus, and it's actually a set of subset in this WD, which is WD was projectivization of D square annihilator, subset of points in which such that it's a subset of all points lambda in WD such that the germ of J gamma lambda at lambda is convex, where gamma is abnormal extremal passing through lambda. Where gamma is abnormal extremal passing through lambda. And we will say that rank two distribution is of maximal class at a given point if the intersection of the fiber of Q with this Jacobi regular locus is not empty.
What does it mean for the Gross vector, maximal class?
I will tell you it now, okay? So in general, like for the Gross vector, the only restriction is that the cube of distribution is phi. Like for 2, 3, 4, it will be not of maximal class, but in general, it can be like if 2, 3, 4 distribution actually can be quotient. And I mean, 2, 3, 4, and then something. It can be quotient, and then there is a process to obtain by this quotient procedure 2, 3, 5. I mean, the only thing is like, the question here is the slide about, I mean, what distributions are of maximal class and what distributions are not. It's actually an open question, but first of all, generic germs of rank two distributions are of maximal class. Second, we don't have any example of rank two bracket generating distribution with d cube dimension of d cube is equal to 5, which are not of maximal class. Now, third, actually.
So conjectures that they do not exist, or it is a theory?
Conjecture, yes, conjectures they do not exist.
Okay.
So it, but we were not able to prove it actually. Okay. So it, and so one simple thing, I mean, observation that distribution D is of maximal class at a given point, if the flat distribution corresponding to the Tanaka symbol of D at Q is of maximal class. So if you know that like the nilpotent approximation, like the flat, if you know that the left invariant distribution on the nilpotent Lie group corresponding to the Tanaka symbol is of maximal class, then the distribution itself is of maximal class. So therefore, basically, it's enough actually to check this conjecture for flat distributions. So
for flat, even for flat distribution, it is not easy to understand where the class is maximal, where it's not.
Yes, in general, like, I mean, maybe it's easy, but I don't know how to do it. In general, like, when you calculate this, like, when you calculate this flag, you obtain a lot, it's a lot of calculation. So basically this singular locus, the singular locus is determinant of very, I mean, it's actually the zero level set of determinant of some very high degree polynomial. And you have to make sure that this polynomial is not identically zero. And like, I had a master student, Eric Wendell, we together did like write master thesis about some particular cases, but we did not publish it because we did not feel that it is really like satisfactory. So, yes. So first of all, if we prove that all rank two distributions with dimension of cube equal to 5 are of maximal class if degree of holonomy is less or equal than 4. So like, so 235(6), 235(7), 235(8) of this, this is small, is this is answering your question partially, very partially, like the distribution with the growth vector 235, and then k between 6 and 8 of maximum class. Now if you consider the free distribution with small growth vector with free, rank two distribution is 14 dimensional with a free symbol. So, the symbol must be free. So it's the growth vector is 2, 3, 5, 8, 14. So it's also maximal class, but it's really like brute force calculations using computers because like the polynomial.
But for maximal class, the distribution should be regular, meaning that growth vector, meaning that nilpotent approximation is the same at all points, or not?
No.
Not necessarily.
Like here it's not important. Like in this construction, the nilpotent approximation at the point is not important, right? We do not use it at all.
Okay, but and one more question. So within maximal class, Jacobi curves give all invariants or part of invariants of distribution?
This is not known also. Like, I mean, in the case of 2-5, yes, because it's like, but it comes okay. From Cardan, yes.
Okay.
In some particular cases for more of.
So you know it only by comparing the results, right? There are no general theorems about it.
Well, in generally, like there is a technique, but it should be verified and applied. I mean, technique similar to harmonic curvature technique, But the problem is like, I mean, for 2-3-5, you can actually use this technique. But for higher dimensions, since the symmetry algebras are not semi-simple, you cannot immediately use this theory. And so also like for the rank two distribution associated with Monge equation, also gross vector 2-3-5 and then something, for all this, this is of maximal class. And I also know that a former student of Boris, Denis Pirstuk, right, or Boris Dubrov, he also made some calculation in these directions. Maybe I'm not, I mean, there is a thesis of him, and like, anyway, but still it's like open. Okay, and then like, but at least like if in the space in Jacobi regularity locus we have Pearson projective space, and so therefore like now if we know how to construct invariants of Pearson projective space, then they can give us invariants of distributions themselves. And so I like there are rather conceptual theory of Pearson in projective space and in general of Pearson of flux and parabolic spaces, but like I only need sort of I will not give it, but just I will give like highlights of the results. So then, or like maybe I will do it in like in more naive way. So first of all, like there is not returning to the question of Misha, there is no special parametrization, but actually there is a special class of parametrizations. Distinguished parametrization defined up to a Möbius transformation. So the transition from one to another is Möbius. And then if K is a dimension of the projective space, then for a non-degenerate curve, or actually it must be convex curve for in this terminology, for a convex curve in the projective space, the set, we can define the set of fundamental invariants, which can consist of k minus one relative invariants wi of degree I plus two, called the Wilczynski invariant. So from like I see it, what does it mean here, the relative invariant? I see it as like every wi is actually degree I plus two homogeneous polynomial on the tangent line. So it's like a form, like it's wi is actually for every point of a curve, it is a function on the tangent line, and this is actually homogeneous of degree I plus two function. So if we choose a parametrization, then this function can be written in this form, like wi of t is equal to ai of t dt to the power I plus two. And then this ai of t is called the density of Wilczynski invariant with respect to this parametrization. If you choose, you change the parametrization, then the density is multiplied by the corresponding derivative in the power I plus two of the reparametrization. And then for the self-dual curves, they will like only roughly half of Wilczynski invariants are relevant. So because the invariants of odd degree are automatically zero. So, and then like how we can construct or describe at least this Wilczynski invariant. So suppose that a curve. J is a curve in k-dimensional projective space. So then, like, it's a curve of lines. And then at every line, we can choose a generator E of T, yes? So, or a section of J. And the convexity assumption exactly means that if you take, like, E of T is an element of V, right? Is a curve in V, and it, if you take derivative up to order K, so V is, PV is K dimensional, V is K plus one dimensional. So if you take this derivative, then they constitute a basis of V. And then you in general, you can take K plus one's derivative and you can represent it as linear combination of all previous ones. But you have a freedom. I mean, if you fix a parameterization, let's start first fix a parameterization. If you fix a parameterization, yes, and then like you have a freedom to choose the section. You can multiply a section by arbitrary non-zero scalar function, lambda. And then with this choice, you actually can kill a coefficient near the case derivative. So, and so that like the here, like in this decomposition, bk will be equal to zero. And these sections are defined up to a constant, like up to multiplication by this sections with these properties are defined up to multiplication by a constant. So this simple exercise, simple explanation, you just see what happens with this coefficient bk when you make this transformation, change of section, and then like you obtain actually first order ODE for this lambda that has a solution. And if initially bk is zero, then lambda prime is zero. So like the only freedom is multiplication by a constant. So this is
this special optimization simply, it's parameterization of a certain rather simple normal form, right, of the Kolbe curve. You bring it, can I say it?
I still did not arrive to the simple, the special parameterization. I just, at this moment, I fix some parameterization and make a normal form, yes. And next yeah,
but
slide,
now,
yes.
But now you can change parameterization into get a better yes. normal form.
Yes, and then exactly. So like, if I want to kill the next coefficient bk minus one, then it gives me special parameterization, still a set of parameterization, not unique. So this is called, if we can allow reparameterizations, and we allow it because our curve is unparameterized, then we can try, like, we for every parameterization, we use canonical section with respect to this parameterization, but then we want to choose such parameterizations for which also not only bk equal to zero, but bk minus one. And this is called Laguerre forces canonical form. It's very classical, like 19th century. And then it's possible always to do, and such parameterization are defined up to a Möbius transformation and called projective parameters. And then they define canonical projective structure on a curve. And again, the reason for this is just like the naive reason for this is just like you look how you actually look how this bk minus one transforms. So here there should not be t, all right. So you actually can see that bk minus one under reparameterization is transformed as big is goes to bk minus one plus some universal constants times so-called Schwarzian derivative of reparameterization. So Schwarzian derivative of phi is special third order differential operator, and then the property of, and then in fact you have to, like, in order to find the special parameterization, you have to solve the equation Schwarzian of phi is equal to this quantity where bk minus one is bk minus one of the original parameter, and this has always at least locally solution which is defined up to Möbius transformation, because this Schwarzian derivative is characterized by the fact that the Schwarzian of phi is equal to Schwarzian of any Möbius transformation of phi, like Schwarzian of phi is equal to Schwarzian of a phi plus b divided by c phi plus d. And so in this way, you actually obtain this Laguerre forces canonical form. And then indeed, like, now you have only finite dimensional freedom of changing, like previously we could make infinite dimensional set of reparameterization, but here you can just reparameterize by Möbius transformation, finite dimensional freedom of SL of action of group SL2. And then indeed, if you already work with projective parameters, then, and if you collect the very first non-zero, like the term bk minus two, then bk minus two dt cube is the relative invariant of degree three, is the Wilczynski invariant of degree three. So namely, if you consider another projective parameter, namely tau, which is a Möbius transformation of T, then, and if you consider coefficient b tilde k minus two of it, then here it's two, then you have this equality. Yes, so then indeed, like, you have well-defined degree three homogeneous polynomial on each tangent line. And then more generally, actually, the first non-trivial coefficient gives you the first Wilczynski invariant, but like if you consider like the main achievement of Wilczynski work, because like this first invariant was already known, I think, by like
for 2-3-5 distribution, this Möbius transformation for the Jacobi, for the normal form of the Jacobi form, they are G2 group.
No, Möbius transformation is just SL2. I mean, it's
how it matches.
It doesn't, I mean, it's only part. I mean, there is no matching here. I mean, G2 appears after when you make prolongations. This is just SL2 is just like, it will be like G0 part after certain, like if you start with Tanaka procedure, but not on the distribution, but upstairs. It's not related to any matching.
As a part of G2, so this means that for 2-3-5 distribution, Jacobi curve gives you part of the invariance of this.
Jacobi curves is only for abnormal. I mean, it's only for, we use still only partial information, because like here it's not related to G2. I mean, okay, so anyway, so like the main achievement of Wilczynski is that using actually Lissieri, he were able actually to produce all other relative invariant and find the exact formula for them in terms of coefficients of bi and their derivatives. And this is this exact formula. And then like Yutaka Siash in 1982, he gave another more conceptual interpretation of this invariance using a theory of SL2 representation and Tanaka-like theory for curves. And then also you can, Boris Dubrov wrote a very nice survey about it, but I will not speak, I just will use today this formula, I will not speak why it is. But I mean, the other thing that we need is that, I still have some time, right?
Yes, yes. I just wanted to mention that there's, you have like 15 more minutes.
Still 15. Yes, I mean, I think, anyway, so then the point is that we have not only, like we have also, so here it is a theory and the first non-trivial invariant for arbitrary curve in projective space, but we have additional structure. We have the symplectic structure and the curve and our curve in projective space are obtained by osculation and skew symmetric complement of a curve in Lagrange-Grassmannian. And so they are special. And so they are in fact, what is called self-dual. So what is dual and self-dual curve? So given a convex curve J in projective space, we can define its dual in the projectivization of dual space. And for the, and it consists of lines, consists of lines in PV star annihilating the hyperplanes JK minus one obtained from J by the osculation of order K minus one. So what does it mean? So you take J, you osculate it, you obtain complete flux, right? And then you consider the hyperplane from this flux. Yes, JK K minus one is a curve of hyperplanes. And then in the dual space, it corresponds to you can choose a curve of lines annihilating the hyperplanes. So then you obtain actually a curve projective, a curve in PV star. Yes. And then the curve J is called self dual if it is equivalent to its dual, namely, if there is a linear transformation from V to V star, which sends J to J star. And for example, if k is equal to 2m minus 1, namely actually dimension of v is equal to 2m, it's even dimension, then j is self-dual if and only if there exists a symplectic form omega on v, such that the appropriate osculation jm minus 1 becomes Lagrangian with respect to omega. And this is exactly the situation in our case, like omega comes from the symplectic form in the cotangent bundle, and then the Wilczynski also proved that the curve is self-dual if and only if all Wilczynski invariants of odd degree vanish. So namely, like in our case, this W1 is zero. It's all W1 is zero. And so the first non-trivial invariant is actually W2. And this is, so basically the point is that for self-dual curves, for self-dual curve BK minus two is always zero. And so the, like the first non-trivial invariant is this BK minus three DT to the power four. And actually for 2-5 distributions, K equal to three. So, so like actually the dimension of V is four. And this is W2 is the only non-trivial Wilczynski invariant. There is no others. And Okay. So
Igor, you mean 2-3-5 distribution here?
Yes, I mean 2-3-5, right. I mean when I write 2-5, it's not a small growth vector, it's like rank 2 distribution in 5 dimensions. With growth vector 2-3-5. But I mean I here indeed like I only consider the distributions with dimension of d cube equal to 5. Yes.
Uh-huh.
Okay, so well, so then okay, so this is the series that we need from oh, and again, like this fact that Wilczynskian the self dual occurs if and only if Wilczynskian one is of degree, the like the conceptual explanation also comes from representation theory of SL2, but okay, so I will not go to here to the deep anyway. So I'm actually not sure. So I actually have still a lot of material and did not arrive to this calculational thing that actually I want to emphasize. So anyway, I will try to do what I can. So now, okay, so we have a known series of Kurs and Lagrange in projective space. And so how we can actually use it and how we can go back from Kurs and projective space to distributions and actually to construct this, like to associate the Wilczynski invariants for Kurs and projective space with some invariants of distributions themselves, and in particular, like this W2 for 2-5 distribution is actually can be associated or it coincides with Cartan quartic or Cartan the Cartan tensor. So, like, first of all, so how we go back to distribution? So, first of all, let us choose a local basis of distribution x1, x2. And after all, we will see that the construction actually doesn't depend on the choice. And then we can let for us it will be important to have like to denote x3 is x1, x2, and x4 is x1, x3, x5 is x2, x3. And then we can introduce quasi impulses, which are of the vector field xi. So these are functions on the cotangent bundle. So ui lambda is equal just to p acting on xiq, right? P is a covector, xi of q is vector, so it's p acting on xiq. And then, like, for example, d squared annihilator can be represented as a common level set of U1, U2, and U3. Then the other thing, like standard thing from Hamiltonian formalism, is that given a function on T star M, you can assign to it a vector field, capital H. So here it is capital H such that it satisfies this identity. So it's H is regarded as Hamiltonian and vector H is regarded as Hamiltonian vector field. So here you use the fact that sigma is non-degenerate to form. And then in these notations, the characteristic one distribution that we defined has a very simple expression. It's just u4 vec u2 minus u5 vec u1. And so also you see here why d cube annihilator is problematic, because in this case u4 and u5 is zero. So it like this characteristic, like you have a vec, you have a singularity here. And then let us fix the notation. So for given basis x1 and x2, you have u4, u2 vec minus u5 u1. Vec is denoted by vec h x1 x2. And again, I recall that we have this Jacobi regularity set, namely the set where j gamma lambda is convex. And then all these constructions we can do for the Jacobi regularity set. So like we start with some lambda in Rd, and suppose that like W2i lambda, we know that like W2i lambda be the two i's Wilczynski invariant of the Jacobi curve, J gamma at lambda. So should not be tilde here. Oh, anyway, so, and so you have, so we know that only even dimensional Wilczynski invariant are non-trivial. So like you have for given rank two distribution in n dimension, you have n minus four Wilczynski invariants. So for five, it's one Wilczynski invariant, for n equal to six is two. And we know that this W2i lambda is a degree two times I plus one homogeneous function on the tangent line to gamma. Yes, we know that on the tangent line to gamma, it is homogeneous two times I plus one function on the tangent space, right? And then like we fix this local basis x1, x2, right? Then what we can do, we can actually to any lambda, we can assign a number. Namely, you can put like W2i lambda is homogeneous function on the tangent line. And vec h is a generator of this tangent line. So you can put this vec h into W2i lambda, and then you obtain a number, right? So in a sense, like if like this h x1 x2 defines your parameterization, like choosing x1 x2, you actually define a parameterization of abnormal extremals. Of course, it's not canonical because like you have a lot of choices. But anyway, so but and then like actually this AI, so AI, so here I use 2i, here I use I just. Well, because I mean, I know that the only information is coming from even. So anyway, so this AI in fact is the density of the Wilczynski invariant. Is the density of the Wilczynski invariant in this parameterization given by this vector field. Now, what happens if we change a basis? The effect of basis change and generalized Wilczynski invariant of rank two distribution. So if you consider another basis of distribution, so like you like and u is a transition function from one basis to another, then actually it affects only on multiplication of, so the corresponding Hamiltonian vector field is obtained from the original one by multiplication by a function of a base, which is determinant u squared. Yes, so it means and then using we know that it is W2i is homogeneous. It means that like for a given basis we have a function on a base or on a fiber. Like you have a function on a fiber, right? If you change a basis, then you obtain another function, but on each fiber it is equal to the previous one multiplied by some constant, right? Because like this factor depends only on the fiber. Namely, the restriction of this AI x1 x2 is a well-defined function up to the multiplication on positive constant, which is called the I's generalized Wilczynski invariant of D. So like this is the way how you construct. So the object is that like the invariant is a function on the fiber of PD squared annihilator, or projectivization of D squared annihilator. This function may have singularities because like it is well defined only on the Jacobi regularity locus, and in general like it can be shown, it's easy to show that this function is not, in general, is not polynomial. It has singularities, but what we know is that it is degree 2 times I plus 1 homogeneous rational function on D squared. Yes, so like, and for every I, you have special 2 times I plus 1 homogeneous rational function.
So this gives you some steps to obtain canonical frame for distribution.
Canonical frame for distributions it gives you like it can be obtained using this projective structure. You can construct also canonical frame. Right, but today I plan only to discuss the construction of invariants. Now, like for maybe like as a very last slide for today. So like what about case n equal to 5? How it's actually related to Cartan quartic? So you can actually interpret this W2 in the unique W2 in this case is Cartan quartic. Why? Because in this case, actually there is no singularities. So this Jacobi regular locus is the whole projectivization of D squared annihilator. By the way, in this case, projectivization of D cube, sorry. Yes, projectivization of D cube, here is cube, is empty. And so WD is just projectivization of D squared. And in this case, like you have actually one-to-one, you have actually, you can canonically associate P projectivization of D squared annihilator with the projectivization of D, where like projectivization of D is the fiber bundle over M with fibers equal to the projective space of D. And how you do it? For every lambda here, you take like C of lambda, the characteristic line, and you project it by pi star to M and you obtain a line in D. And so the point is that what happens here, like you give, like how you construct this quartic. So you suppose that you have a point Q and this is a vector V. And then you vector V, which is tangent to distribution. Then you consider there exists exactly one vector V hat exists exactly one lambda in the fiber of PD square annihilator and exactly one generator V hat of the line characteristic line distribution on this fiber, such that P star V hat is equal to V. So like basically you have one to like the fiber is one dimensional and the projectivization of D is one dimensional. So it means that at any direction of distribution, there exists exactly one abnormal trajectory. And to this abnormal trajectory, there is lift, the unique abnormal extremal, which projects to this abnormal trajectory. Yes. And then like for given V, you can actually assign the head, and you can apply this, what I calculated, this Vilchinsky invariant W2 lambda to this V hat. And so you obtain, to any V, you obtain a number. To any V in distribution, you obtain a number. And it defines a defined degree 4 homogeneous function, which is actually, in this case, is polynomial because we don't have singularities. And this is exactly Cartan quartic.
It is your fundamental form. You call it fundamental form. Yeah.
Yes, it's, I mean, basically, the, what I call fundamental form is this W2. In general, W2, I call fundamental form. But of course, like using Vilchinsky invariant, you can construct other like higher order fundamental forms. So this is probably I have to stop now. Yes.
Yeah. Thank you very much.
Yes. In general, I actually plan to give calculational steps like for constructing these forms and also some calculations in the dimension n equal to 6.
Igor, I already asked you what I would like to ask again in order to once again to clarify for myself, and maybe some other people also would like to clarify. So, Vilchinsky invariant of the surface is Jacobi curve. So, a part of them are invariants of the Nilpotent approximation bundle, in general case when it depends on a point. The other part are invariants of Nilpotent approximation. Is it true, right?
I don't quite understand.
In general case of two n distributions.
The construction of this invariants are independent of Tanaka symbol and independent on nilpotent approximation. But
anyhow, Tanaka symbol exists. Nilpotent approximation exists. A part of your invariants, Vilchinsky invariants of Jacobi, associated Jacobi curves, are invariants of nilpotent approximation, right?
These are invariants of distributions, and like it's a good question because yes. So how like the of course like. Nilpotent approximations must be seen from Vilchinsky invariants in some point, or from the construction of Vilchinsky invariants.
Okay, Vilchinsky invariants are complete invariants of nilpotent approximation or not?
Vilchinsky invariants are invariants of distributions. They are not related.
If they're invariants of distributions, they are also invariants of nilpotent approximation.
They are also invariants of nilpotent approximation. So you mean that can we actually reconstruct nilpotent approximation from Vilchinsky invariant? This is my question.
Yeah.
Yes. So like actually what I wanted, I mean the main goal of this talk was like to discuss this 2, 3, 5, 6 distributions. So like in general, what are the questions? So here you have this Jacobi regularity locus and then the complement of it is singular set. And the question is, what is the singular set? And actually from the singular locus, you can reconstruct nilpotent approximation.
Let us consider regular case. There are no any singular locus.
No, it's regular. Sorry. There is singular locus always. We consider regular case. Like you consider 2, 3, 5, 6 distributions, for example. We speak about singular locus in WD in the predictivization of D square annihilator. there is singular locus always, like there are always points for which these Jacobi curves are not like the flag of Jacobi curve is not regular. I mean, the point is that this construction, this invariant that I construct, they may be too general. I mean, they actually can, I mean, you can extract from the, like, they are too general. Indeed, like, they do not use Tanaka symbol at all. But maybe let me give you, like, you can see it in 2356 case the best. Like, in 2356 case, there is, like, in 2356 case, on a distribution, there is a conformal structure. On a distribution, there is a well-defined quadratic form on the fibers of distribution.
Yeah,
Just a moment. Yes, I'm answering your question. Yes. So then the symbol depends on the signature of this distribution. You have exactly three symbols: elliptic when B is sign definite, parabolic if it is degenerate, and hyperbolic. Yes. Then this singular set, which always exists, is the set of all lambda in the projectivization of D square, which projects such that the characteristic foliation projects to zero cone of this, conformal structure of this special quadratic form. And so the invariants, the Wilczynski invariants, are rational functions with denominators which are certain powers of this form. Yes, so like you this form indeed defines you a form also a quadratic polynomial on the fibers of PD squared, and then like you obtain rational functions, and the singularities or denominators of this rational function are exactly determines in this case the Tanaka symbol. Okay, the Tanaka symbol sort of involved in the algebraic structure of this environment. This was the main message of my talk, but the problem is that, like, if like you have the singular locus, if the characteristic foliation is not tangent to singular locus, then indeed you have denominator. So there is this a rational function. If it is tangent, but however, if it is tangent, for example, to level sets, then the denominator disappears. It is canceled. And for example, exactly for if you calculate it for nilpotent distributions, then okay, so then like if like for parabolic ones, like for if you consider this three nilpotent three symbols and three flat distributions for each symbol, for parabolic ones A1 and A2 are always zero. Like here you have two Wilczynski invariants.
Okay.
And for parabolic ones they are always zero for parabolic one. But for hyperbolic ones they are polynomials, one of degree 4 and one of degree 6. So they indeed can be cancelled. On the other hand, the algebraic structure, it should be actually simple. There is certain representation here, theory here, like you have a rational function, right? And you have quadratic polynomial. And then you actually sort of, you can decompose say numerator, like you can decompose say decompose the set of polynomials. You have action here, quadratic. You have quadratic form, for example, an elliptic case. You have an action of SO2, so you can decompose your numerator into irreducible components like harmonic polynomials and harmonic polynomials multiplied by the powers of this quadratic form. So I mean, the point is that indeed the open question is how like this Wilczynski invariant in general are too general, and they contain a lot of information, including nilpotent approximation, including stuff. Yeah, but, and then the question is how to extract this.
Do you have an example when Wilczynski invariant do not know nilpotent approximation? Two different distributions with the same Wilczynski invariant and different nilpotent approximation. Is it possible?
I don't think so, but I don't know exact answer to this question.
Don't you think that it is important?
Any other questions?
I'm not sure about it. Okay, so I'm not sure. So if I mean, since I actually did not arrive to the main point of my talk, so maybe I will just next time I just continue this and.
Peter, may I ask you the last question, and I will not bother you with your privacy then. The last question, how much you use that you have two distributions? Why you cannot construct the Jacobi curve for three distributions?
We constructed it for distribution of any rank.
So why you concentrate on two distributions here?
Because you wanted if I will start now to speak about for two distributions I actually was not able to describe the theory, right? I mean in the case of rank two distributions we have curves in projective space. In the case of distribution of higher rank, we have curves of flux of symplectic flux, namely they consist of isotropic and coisotropic flux. I mean, we have the theory. It's published in ArcSieve. We have a notion of Jacobi symbol. Like the rank two distribution is just more simple to describe because you have geometry of curves and projective spaces. Like in other cases, like the theory of curves itself, curve of flux itself is rather complicated. I mean, we did construct it, but yes.
Public talk to everything I wanted. Thank you very much.
Yes, I mean, my question is if I should maybe continue next time with this and give more examples, or like if I should stop at this point. But I mean,
useful examples in local coordinates. I don't know how other people, but I would like to have an example with a part of these constructions expressed in local coordinates in order to understand better.
So I mean, like the computational method that I use or is actually in local frames. Like I fix a local basis of distribution, then basically you have computational method. It's like something like this. So like you have particular vector fields in the tangent bundle, and then like you take iterative brackets. This is a computational method.
I'm not sure that it is doable for a talk, especially Zoom talk, but I would be interested in a bit more details about this computation because
in general I will send you the file. Of course I Yes, I actually found the miss. Unfortunately, I tried to read all this, and but still I found a lot of misprints. So I will correct misprints, and I will send you the presentation.
Igor, can I maybe ask you a question?
Yes.
Thanks for the talk. Let's go back to the example of the rolling balls. Okay, so in this case, when you compute your W2 invariant, that's your Cartan tensor. It's a quartic, it's of root type D. And we know all root type Ds, I mean, up to GL2 transformations, and if you complexify, they're equivalent.
Yes.
So where are you seeing the ratio of the radii being an invariant?
In a coefficient. You have a specific coefficient, which is, I can say, let me see.
Inside the W2 invariant or inside some other invariant that you've computed?
So inside of it's when we speak about this tangential Wilczynski. So I can say, I actually have a paper in front of me. I can actually share this. Maybe share this. Let me check. It just you multiply by yes.
But you could see all the redundancies associated with the like say it's called R. So you could see that R goes to 1/R, or if you flip the sign that
yes, you have a coefficient.
Yeah.
Okay, let me just share the paper. If you want. I mean, you have like sum of squares like multiplied by 9. Sorry, it's wrong. So you don't have it's wrong. So I mean you don't have it like on the level of in what like you only see if it is zero or not, right?
Yeah.
On the level of fundamental form, you only see if it is zero or not. But then, like, if it is not zero, right? Then one way to see it is like, then if it is not zero, then you can consider special parametrization of your curve in which the density is equal to one, right?
Okay.
I mean, once it is non-zero, then you kill this SL2. You can actually find a canonical parameter
if
it is not zero, you can find the canonical parameter, and then it is already parameterized curve, right? And then you actually can consider this invariant BK minus one. I mean, BK minus one for this parameter. It's
case three in this case, right? Yeah, case three in this
4235. K is equal to three, right? So like you have like in this parameter k is equal to three, right? And then like you killed b3 and then you consider b2 in this particular parameter, and this b2 is non-zero, right? B2, I mean, this b2 is an invariant now.
Well, I thought you could always kill the first two.
You can always kill the first two, right? But here you already have specific parameterization for which, like, based on the fact that your W2 is non-zero.
Yeah.
Yes. You can choose specific parameter in which W2 is like just dt to the power 4 or plus minus. Yes, I mean if I call this density, like for each parameter you have its own density, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then like you can always make this density one or minus one depending on the sign of original density. Yes, And once you have this density, you it means that you have a, like with in the, this parameter is uniquely defined up to a shift, right? So you sort of reduce your group SL2 to just to a shift.
Yes. Yeah.
And in this case, it means that the Wilczynski, oh, sorry, you don't need Wilczynski invariants. You just, you already, your Jacobi curve is parameterized. So you have a specific parameterization. And then like you don't need this part, Laguerre forces. You use this specific parameterization and for the frame for which BK, B3 is equal to zero, all other coefficients are already invariants of distribution.
Okay. So, but there's several coefficients there, and
there are several coefficients,
they're all going to be functions of the ratio of the radius, radii.
They all will be functions of ratio of the radii, right?
Yeah. Okay. But there are still group of affine transformations, not only shift, right? So it's, you also have scaling.
But here you don't need the fun. There is no, because of simple existence of symplectic structure, in this case you can reduce to a shift because like you exactly can make it equal to one, not to constant.
No, but that's relative invariant, right? So it's defined up to multiplication by constant.
No, in okay.
So
Once you have this specific parameterization, in the specific parameterization, it will be already not relative invariant. Okay, so what is this W2? W2 is degree 4 homogeneous function on the tangent line, right? If this homogeneous function is non-zero, then you can choose unique up to a sign generator of this tangent line for which this function is one or minus one. Yes? So it means that you actually have a canonical. So it's not a line distribution now, not C, but you have a canonical generator. So and then it means that, yes, like for unparameterized curve is a relative invariant. But once one of this relative invariant is non-zero, you can actually find a canonical parameterization. So did I answer Boris Kruglik? Did I answer your question? Or you still doubt about?
That was Dennis's question, right? So we all sit together here. But I still don't understand how can you remove actually one scale because you have, which is square of quadric, right? And you have tangent vector which we just substitute, and you normalize both by the condition that the substitution gives you one. You can't normalize by one condition two scales.
Well, again, so you have this quartic, right? Just a quartic, it's not defined as a multiplication up to a multiplication. It's just a quartic, it's well-defined function of degree four on a tangent line. You just take unit ball of this. Where you have another constant.
But this quartic is a relative invariant.
It's not relative. By relative invariant, I mean this relativity is exactly this dt to the power four. I mean, what you mean by the relative invariant is the density. It's probably a different terminology. So like I look on the like BK minus three of T, this density is relative invariant under the parameterization is multiplied by the force derivative of,
the
derivative. Yes. But BK minus three DT to the power four, it's already an invariant. Just it is a, at every point is it is a form.
Okay, okay.
And then you make special reparametrization for which the density becomes one. You or minus, if it is not zero, then you can make it like, because it's to the power four, you cannot change the sign. But anyway, it's plus or minus one, right? And it gives you a special parameter.
Yeah.
So both bk minus three and bk minus one, they lie in they're in this same time of type of density, because the center of GL2 is two dimensional. But they, you're saying that if you normalize one of them to one, then the other one is also well defined. There's no ambiguity in terms of scale.
I just would say that, I mean, you think about it maybe in more simple terms, right? You want like at every point, you have a well-defined generator of the tangent line up to a sign. If you have a well-defined generator of a tangent line up to a sign, it means you have a canonical parametrization up to a shift.
And just one more question. Are there examples of, can they, after normalizing this to one, is it possible to choose the radii so that one of the other ones, this pk minus one, is also constant, or it's just too difficult to put any conditions on them to make them?
Bk minus, like, yes, like then bk minus one becomes invariant, right?
Yeah, and then if you put it
and the then constant, it becomes indeed like in the rolling balls, it will be a constant. So this is what we called in that time projective Ricci curvature. I mean, indeed, like for this specific case, when the fundamental when Wilczynski invariant is not zero, then you can make immediately reduction, as you all know, but like B and then BK. Then it becomes not unparameterized curves, but parameterized curves. And then indeed, like instead of Wilczynski invariants, you have all these BIs become invariants. And the very first one, BK minus one, yes, you can ask when it is constant. Like I made a lot of like 16 years ago, I wanted actually to write a paper about about like when like of structures when it's a constant, but it was not completed anyway.